And this happens, it's not an everyday occurrence that it would happen, but it would happen, regularly, commonly is the right word. It happens. It happens at all the parks. We don't make that decision as a trainer. It has to have management approval, and usually we would have to have a vet approval. So no one can claim, come back and say, well, those aren't our policies. That was a rogue trainer that just made that decision. Anytime that was to be done, I had to pick up the phone and I had to call senior management and say, is there approval to cut this animal's base for the day? And they say yes or no. And unless that animal had been sick, they would say yes, cut it. So some of the more drastic examples that I know of, animals that eat 180 to 250 pounds a day, getting as little as 59 pounds of food for the day. All strictly for behavioral reasons. I do. You know, I think that there are some great aspects to the rescue and rehab, but it's hard for me, though, even to say that, because I feel a lot of it is a mask, so to speak, because they only, the numbers that I received, is they only spend 0.48% of their annual revenue towards rescue and rehabilitation. So to me, a company that's one of their main talking points is conservation through education, and that's the whole reason why they have this parks. That doesn't really seem to be one of their main core values if they're only spending 0.48%. I mean, the church expects you to pay 10%. So 0.48% is pretty drastic, you know, incredibly low.
They have such strong criticisms about their core values. Why did it take you so long to leave, and why did it take you so long to speak out against you?
That's a very good question. I still have a lot of conflict with that myself. I have to think about it. I think the main thing in the beginning, growing up in the 70s and 80s, I never thought about animal captivity being wrong. I mean, I remember going to rinky-dink Cyorama in Galveston with this solitary killer whale was in the most horrific conditions. You don't think that this is wrong yet at that stage because you don't know any different. And, but as time went on, and then when you start, I'll just jump ahead to when I started when I was 20 years old. I've achieved my dream job. I've wanted it since I was 6 years old. And then two, most importantly, you don't know yet what is normal or abnormal. Like the killer whale, the way their teeth are gauged, the dorsal fins, you don't know. I didn't know. Does that happen in the wild? Is this normal in the wild? Is this an age-related issue? Is this just one specific animal that has a health issue? You don't know those things yet until you gain experience and you start to realize, oh, they have these teeth issues because they're bored and they're wearing down their teeth. And that is what makes us to perform the hippopotomy, where we have to drill the teeth and then invasively irrigate it. And, you know, so it just takes a while in your growth process and getting promoted up through the ranks, first for you to see it and realize, oh, this does not happen naturally in the wild. This is a result from captivity. And then you're the trainer that is doing it. You are the one that is drilling the teeth. You are the one that is doing the artificial insemination. You are the one that is assisting in separating the mothers from the calves. Even when you don't agree with it, and trust me, I was an extremely vocal trainer and I fought management for years, especially the last 4.5 of my career, and I was in trouble all the time, but I couldn't stop it.
I don't understand how you can abuse and imprison them for almost 15 years, and it seems like now you're only speaking out because you had the opportunity to be in this feature film, and now you're on this book tour. I don't understand.
Well, to answer your question, so to help you to understand, is that I didn't just start speaking out when I went on Blackfish. I've been speaking out for years, fighting with senior management.
Why didn't you just leave if it was so bad?
Because when you have a relationship, sure. That's right.
I'm trying to
your support, and that's exactly right. It's extremely tough when you love those animals and you have those relationships. It is not so easy to just walk away, especially when you feel like you can fight from the inside and make the change. So thank you for your question.
Thanks, John. I'd just like to say, who better to look after them while they have to than someone who actually really cares and loves them. Anyway, my question is, do you see an end to cetacean captivity in the future, and what kind of timescale do you think we're looking at?
It's definitely it's happening right now. I mean, if you look at, I don't think any of us expected, like after blackfish, what happened and how quickly it is happening. I mean, now you look at the legislation that's happening even in the states with New York, Washington State, California. I mean, these laws are already, I mean, we're almost there. So things are happening at a lightning speed now, and I think it's because, you know, this debate has been going on for years, but a lot of people were not necessarily involved. Films like Blackfish really helped to push it to the, you know, mainstream consciousness. And the public, all they need is a little bit of education. Because if you don't know, you don't think about it, like me growing up in the 70s and 80s and not really thinking about captivity, animal captivity being wrong. But once you're given a little bit of information, we all have brains, you become very wise, you start thinking on your own, and you start to have these issues where you're saying, wait a second, this is a moral and ethical problem for me. And you think about it more and we evolve. And, you know, every decade we evolve as a society on all types of social justices. And Jane Velez Mitchell, I think she said it best when she said, this is the emerging social justice of the 21st century. You know, it's time people are finally starting to realize we should not be doing these things to these animals for exploitation and for profit and for entertainment. We should not be putting animals in captivity for those reasons. So it takes a long time to get to that point, and then you really.
So they're just not throwing everyone in the water.
I'm sorry.
They're not just like.
No, you know.
And they're not just like throwing everyone into the water. No, you guys have a very clear understanding that you're putting yourself in a dangerous situation.
Absolutely, I was always very keenly aware that it was dangerous. Like there was never a point where I just thought, oh, these are cuddly teddy bears and I'm not in any danger. I always knew that. And me personally, I survived 10 major waterwork aggressions, so I know very well what that feels like. It's not fun, but you know what you're dealing with. At the end of the day, it is a killer whale, it's a wild animal. They're free-thinking animals, and they can make that choice make that decision at any time. And it's a risk that you take. But good question, and I know they have the audio, so.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I just am trying to comprehend.